It's a talk about control theory. And the problem of control,
as you may know, is so I'm here at this current moment in time, and I want to be in the future at some other state. How do I get there in the cheapest, best, most efficient way? So it's about past planning towards it in the future. And so so for instance, in this giant wants to move this tree trunk from his current position onto the head of his opponent, such a way to crush him maximally. And there's energy involved in this action. There's energy, there's cost. So cost in terms of energy of moving the tree trunk, in which you can do it in an efficient way or a less efficient way. And there's cost involved in sort of a measurably performance. At the end, how close you get to actually killing your opponent. So this is an optimal control problem consisting of a past cost and an end cost. Now, the talk will be about stochastic optimal control. This is about uncertainty, having uncertainty in the world. And I always illustrate that with this very simple example, why you want to consider stochastic optimal control. So consider this little spider that wants to go home. And he can either walk over this rickety bridge, or that's on the left, or he can walk around the lake. So if there is no uncertainty in the problem, then clearly the optimal strategy to do is to walk over, take the shortest path, which is over the bridge. But now suppose that the spider has been drinking at night and he's coming home, and so there is not 100% a certain relation between his intended movements and the actually resulting physical behavior. So there may be a 10% chance that if he wants to go left, he actually goes right. And so you can see what happens. He goes onto the bridge, and there's a fair chance that he will fall off. And so since spiders, we all know that spiders hate to get wet, so he now there's a high cost associated with this path, and the expected cost is very high. And so now the optimal path is actually to walk around the lake. And the morale of the story is that by adding just a little bit of uncertainty to your problem, the qualitative nature of the solution changes drastically from going over the bridge. So you get a quantitative change by adding uncertainty to the problem. And of course, you can think of many daily life situations where that is the case. So that's why this is an interesting setting. Furthermore, it arises very much in the context of exploration. So if you don't know, so this noise, the source of this noise may be actually, you have to act while you don't know yet your world. So that's a source of uncertainty where this optimal stochasticity enters into control planning. And of course, in learning, this is a very natural setting to consider this stochastic component to the optimal control. There are three hard problems associated with optimal control. First of all, there is maybe a problem that's emphasized in the reinforcement learning literature is actually to learn what you have to control. So if you buy the new robot, you get it out of the box, it has some arms, etc. It has a few knobs that you can, or so a few inputs that you can apply voltages. And the first problem is what is the relation between the voltages that you put in and the resulting motion of that robot? So basically, you have to identify the plant, as the engineers call it. And this is a learning problem, and it's an exploration problem in the sense that you don't want to get a full picture of the state space, but you only want to explore that part of the state space that is relevant for the kind of task that you want to solve. That's the first problem. Now, once you have that, the second problem becomes actually to compute in this model that you have of this robot, to compute the optimal course of actions. And this is a computation that results in the Bellman equation, and that by itself is a very complex computation. So there's model-based control, you have the model, the model specifies the plant, it specifies the cost associated, so you know everything basically, and now you just are in your current state, and you ask yourself the question, what is my optimal action in this current state? And that question is intractable in the case of having a stochastic optimal control problem, in the sense that it suffers from recursive dimensionality, it scales exponentially with a problem size. But then there is a third problem. So once you have solved the first two problems, you have your optimal controller, and this basically is an infinite dimensional object, because you have a very large state space, which may be continuous, and you have an action space, which may be also continuous. So you have this beast, which is u, x of t, x is a state, t is time, and u is some control, and this thing you have to store somehow, and it looks very small there on the screen, but in fact it's very big, it can fill your whole brain or your whole computer, so there's also a very big problem there. So I will talk not about the first problem, but I will basically talk about the second and the third problem. So this was observed by not Hamlet, but somebody, I don't know who observed. But anyway, so it's a paraphrasing Hamlet. So to compute or not to compute, that's the question. And so if you think about this control computation, you can think about two ways of doing. There are two extreme ways of doing. You say, okay, let me pre-compute for any possible state the optimal control and just get it over with. Right? That's one absurd sort of extreme case. You could imagine doing that in a sort of case. You need a massive storage device to store that solution, and then you're done. You're fast because everywhere you can, you have a lookup table basically to do what you want. The other extreme is to say, okay, no, that's too expensive. So let's just do it on the fly. So I come into a certain state, and in that state, I'm just going to compute control, optimal control there. Then I have a small memory problem. I don't have to store much, but I have a computational problem. And so we will take time. So you can imagine if you encounter a tiger in the wood, you don't want to have the second option because it will take you too much time to do. So neither of these extremes is very good, right? And you can imagine intuitively somewhere in the middle is where the solution is. And people in manufacturing, they call it just-in-time manufacturing. Right? It's like just-in-time manufacturing. You don't know what the demand is going to be, but you have to prepare a certain amount of your basic half products, say, in order to do this computation. So intuitively, you pre-compute certain parts of the actions that you think that you can then use in the current situation that you need then to fine-tune your control. I mean, considering these two extremes that I sketched before, how to deal with this seems to me like the only way that you can in principle deal with it. Now I think the brain probably does it in some way in this way, right? So you learn certain new skills, you learn them by the hard way, by doing all the real-time computation at that time, and certain things are pre-computed, and you combine it in a certain way. So there's a lot of words, and you can ask people now, how is it going to put this into anything sensible? So in this control theory that I will discuss, this is what I try to then convey to you, this story. So the idea is that there are certain class of control problems that you can express as inference computations. So instead of solving this high-dimensional Bellman equation, you will have a very difficult inference problem to solve. An inference problem basically meaning that you have to sample trajectories in some stochastic process, and then you collect some statistics, and miraculously, based on those statistics, you get the optimal control. So that is part one. And then the second part is that say, okay, this sampling procedure may not be very efficient. It's an inefficient sampling procedure. But there are known ways to make this sampling procedure more efficient, which is known as important sampling. So in this context, this important sampling takes the form of a state feedback controller. So remember, we're trying to compute the optimal control, which is a controller. But in this, the machinery that you use to compute the optimal control is a sampling procedure, which is a sampling of trajectories. And these trajectories that you sample use a certain control, in fact. And this controller tells you how to steer your beam of particles in one direction or the other. And steering it more optimally, I give you a better sampler and a better way to compute your optimal control, right? And so and you can argue that there's an optimal way to sample. And it turns out that in this theory, the optimal way to sample coincides actually with the optimal control that you're trying to compute. So you're biting yourself in your own tail. So if you were to have the optimal controller, you could sample with it, and it's optimal in the sense that you only need one sample, to actually compute your optimal control. But you already have the optimal control, so it's a nonsense kind of a thing, but it's sort of an ideal situation that you want to aspire to. But you get the picture that having a better controller to sample, you can sample more efficiently. And this learning process, where you adapt your controller getting better and better, is in fact the way you gradually go from a completely sample-based thing, where you say you have to compute it all the flow that I in the previous slide that I said that you, you know, one extreme is to just say I'm in the current state, I just have to sample the hell out of it to compute the optimal control. You go from learning to a completely learned sampler, a completely learned controller, and you can be anywhere in between there. And of course you will be somewhere in between there because you cannot learn it perfectly. That's what this story is about. So how to learn then? So this learning is then you will, the learning of course by definition almost is a parameterized model, right? The learning means you have a bunch of parameters and these have to be adapted. And once you to do something with a bunch of parameters, it's a parameterized model, and you deviate from the optimal controller. So your optimal controller, which is your optimal way to steer your particles, is probably not in this class of parameterized in this model. But you want to get the parameters that are as close as possible to this optimal controller. And so you get this picture that your control is actually generating your samples. And the samples that you use, that are then used to generate, they are data, and these data you learn from. And what you learn is this controller. And the controller generates new samples. And these samples generate new, you get new data, and data are learned. So you basically get a procedure in which you generate your own data, and that own generated data will be used to update your controller, and this updated controller will generate new data, etc. So you get this sort of self, this sort of autonomous process, which doesn't require any connection to the outside world, just sort of, you know, hallucinating in its own system. And this is my picture of the brain. So because the brain, at least my brain, I don't know about your brain, but my brain has two realities. So there's one reality which is to deal with the outside world, so in which my brain activity is a slave of what happens out there. I get sensory information in, maybe I have some basic model, I do posterior computation, and blah blah blah, so all very, very happy, and I interact with my brain, I'm in tune with the reality outside. But then there's an inner world in which the brain simulates all kinds of processes which are not really driven by directly by outside events, but which are, it simulates its own activity. And this activity we call thinking, planning ahead, we do what-if scenarios, we dream, all these kinds of things. And this is a lot of scenarios, and these to me sound very similar to the kind of process that I just described to you. So so this is my picture of the brain. It is massive Monte Carlo sampling, which you can massively parallelize, and then this data is used to do gradient computation in some model, which can also be massively parallelized, and then this massive parallel data computation is then used to update your parameters, and the new parameters enter in your new machines to generate new data, which is parallelized, which then give the data can be used to generate gradient updates, and these gradient updates are collected, etc. And this is then so cycling. So this is my picture of the brain. I would suggest that this inner world computation serves three purposes. So this spontaneous activity is some sort of a Monte Carlo sampling. And in the current situation, it is used to compute your best estimate for the current control that you need. So that is your control that you're going to use to kick the ball or whatever you need to do. But at the same time, these samples are used to update your sampler for the future. So motor learning in this context is not learning the motor control, in a sense, but it's learning the sampler that will better, more efficiently generate your motor control. And it's more general because in one extreme, if you have the optimal control, you have the optimal control and you have learned the motor control. But if you have a suboptimal control, it is still a good thing to use to generate the samples to compute your optimal control in the current situation. So that's what this talk is about. How much time do I have left? 20 minutes, okay. So this is the sort of the overview of the talk, and now I'm gonna get a little bit more technical. So for those who are not familiar with control theory, who is not familiar with control theory? Hands, maybe? It's not So, okay, let me do that. So, control problem is the following. So, this is the simplest case. Discrete state, discrete time, fully observed, finite horizon, deterministic. So, and all these conditions can be relaxed, but you have a state variable x, which has a dynamics. So, x at time t moves into x at time t plus 1 with some adding some function, and this function depends on the state and depends on the control. And so if I have given an initial state and a control path, I can, of course, compute the compute state, the complete state path, and then I can ask myself, I can define a cost function, which is a sum of terms, we're running up to a finite horizon, capital T, and then this function is a function of the initial state and of the control path, and I ask myself, which control path minimizes C, right? That is the finite, this is the control problem. And so you can think of it as starting in the initial state A, wanting to move to a final state J, and you want to go through, find a path which is optimal, and optimality is here defined by the smallest numbers on the arcs, and so you want to find a path that does that. And one way to compute that is by dynamic programming. It goes from the observation that suppose that you already, that you know that the, from the state F, you know that the optimal, you can go, either here with cos 6 to state H, or you can go with cos 3 to stage I. And if you know the optimal path to go to the end from here and the cost associated with that, you can basically solve it. So it becomes 6 plus the optimal cost from there, or 3 plus the optimal cost from there. So, right, so you can recurse backwardly. You start here with cost 0, then you compute these costs, which are very trivial, they're just 3 and 4, and then you can compute this, which is recursive in that, and so in this way, you can recurse backwards in time, and that is basically, this iteration is known as dynamic programming, so you express the optimal cost at time t in terms of the optimal cost at time t plus 1, and, right, you recurse backwards. So, so this gives rise to the Bellman equation, which in this gives, so the optimal cost to go is the notion that you should keep in mind. It's very important. It's a scalar value. It's the optimal cost after you solve the control problem from your current state at current time till the end, right? So it's number 5 or 7 or whatever. And so this number is, for each state and time you have such a number, and here it gives a mathematical interrelation that the optimal cost to go is related by simple optimization of all the possible actions that I can take at the moment of the immediate cost that I get in this current situation, plus the cost of the optimal future cost that I get from the current, from the next state, next time at the next state. Okay, this is the Bellman equation. So you can do this also for this diffusion processes in the continuous time, and basically you get the same, if you grasp this notion, you get the same idea. So here now the dynamics is a diffusion process, so x is a continuous n-dimensional variable, and f is a function, and so this is the way that the diffusion evolves over time, and this is the noise, so it has some sort of a noise covariance, and so now the question is to find, given x0, find this function u of x and t such that this expected cost is minimized. Why expected cost? Because that's the thing that you can optimize, right? That's a deterministic quantity, so that you can optimize. You cannot optimize the cost because the cost itself depends on the realization of the noise. So you have to take some statistics of this stochastic process to optimize it. For instance, the expectation value. So you say if an end cost, that is how close I get with my tree trunk on the head of the guy, and I have some path cost, which is how much energy I will exert over this time interval, and I want to minimize the sum of these two terms. And you can do the same reasoning I just did in the discrete case. You set up the Bellman equation, and in this case, because it's continuous in time and space, it becomes a partial differential equation. And it becomes this, you know. I mean, for those who don't like mathematics, you can treat my formulas as pictures, you know. I just listen to my words and you just take it like an illustration of the idea. So it's not really something to take very serious. So this is known as the Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation. One thing that you should keep in mind is that it's solved backwards in time. Because like the dynamic programming, we initialize at the end time, and then we go backwards in time. Here, this partial differential equation is also initialized at the end time, when the cost, the optimal cost is just the end cost, because this integral is empty, and then it's run backwards in time. Okay, that's funny for the brain, right? Running things backwards in time is maybe difficult to do. Okay, so this is hard. So this is hard to solve in general, and only in very special cases can you actually make headway with this Bellman equation. So the idea of these path integral control is that there are several ways to derive it. The way I derive it here is to assume something which is called the notion, this very important notion of uncontrolled dynamics. So we have a dynamical system which has a controller in it, and think of it as the controller U, and this U we can put to zero where we have no control. So this special kind of dynamical system we have, and taking U non-zero is deviating from this uncontrolled dynamics, and for every deviation that you take you have to pay. You're going to deviate, so think of this stochastic process as a beam, like a plume of smoke. And you can control it in uncontrolled, it goes this way. If you put a control, it's going to go into another direction. Right? So, for instance, this is a very general setting. So, you can also think of like chess game, then the uncontrolled dynamics is basically the rules of the game. So, you have the current board position, and there's a number of next board positions which are allowed, which are the moves that you can make. You can put a rope this direction, you can put a horse that direction, and there are things that are not allowed. Also, like here in the grid world, this robot can make single in one time step, make a move here or a move there where he gets penalized, but he cannot make in a single move a move there, right? So so specifying what he can do is the uncontrolled dynamics basically, and it's basically agnostic about the problem for the rest, just specifying what it can do. And in terms of time, it is given by this blue plume of smoke is coming out from this current state, moving into the future, all the possible states that it can by diffusion get into. All the possible chess games that you can play single. But now we want to get to a certain state, which is maybe at the end time is in this state. And now you condition all these blue trajectories onto those ones that end up here. And those are the red ones, right? And now basically you want to compute those ones that end up here. So in this case of the robot, you have random motion, which is, you know, and you want to get to the goal, which is this here. You may bump in all the kind of obstacles. If you do random motion, we will do that, and you will not get to the goal. You want to minimally distort this plume of particles in such a way to absorb, to avoid the obstacles, and to get to the goal. Right? That's the picture. And the way to formalize that is that, say, okay, the trajectory, that's one of these blue wiggly lines, and I associate the cost with it, conditioned on the current state that I start with, as basically being some end cost, that is, you know, how, you know, do I get to the goal, and some path cost, which is the cost of making the path. So think of all the rollouts, and this is the cost. So in this particular example, we only have end cost, so this term is empty, and we have only this end cost. And so now the control problem is to find the distribution P that deviates from Q in a minimal way. So Q is the distribution of trajectories. P is the one we want to find. It's another distribution of trajectories. We want to find one that's close to it, and I will explain you why in a minute. We want to find one that's close to it, and at the same time that it minimizes this cost and expectation. Right? So that's what you want. So the way to do that is in terms of KL divergence. I'm sure you're not surprised by that. So you say, okay, Q is a distribution, P is a distribution, is over trajectories, but I can take the KL divergence of it, which is the definition, so the integral of all trajectories of this thing, and plus the expected cost on the rest. So I want to minimize this as sum. So I want, this is my control problem. So this is a function, it's a functional distribution, and I can find P that minimizes that. Well, it's a one-line differentiation that you take the minimum of this, so you may have done it, and you get the optimal solution that P star is basically Q e to the minus s, and then you have to normalize it. You have to introduce a Lagrange multiplier to get the normalization, and the normalizer is just making sure that this numerator integrates to 1, or this whole expression integrates to 1, basically meaning that phi is just the integral of this numerator here, right? So this is psi. So this is the optimal control solution that you see here. And this you can write as this is a path integral. It's an integral of a path weighted by the uncontrolled dynamics, and then measuring weighting by the expected cost. Right? So you can write this as basically expectation of a Q of e to the minus s. And so if you fill this solution back into here, you will find that the optimal cost to go that is the cost of the optimal solution, is minus the log of this thing. So here you see a very nice relation between control theory, which is as the optimal cost to go, which is this quantity now. This is the optimal cost to go. And this is expressed actually as a log partition sum. Right? So it's like it's a free energy. So it's log partition sum is a free energy. So you get a relation between statistical physics as in terms of free energy and control in terms of optimal cost to go. Okay, so this is the way that you, this is a bit abstract, so let's put some beef in it. If you now, if you do this for diffusion processes, it turns out that this term is, then now the diffusion processes are not any kind of diffusions, but they are diffusion of this type, where the control is additive, in this sense, multiplied by some nonlinear function. And so these are the type of controls that, kind of processes that we now allow. So instead of optimizing over distributions P, which are generated by this process, we're now optimizing over control functions, controllers, which are in here. And the uncontrolled dynamics is this Q, is the one that you get if you put this U function equal to zero. That is when nothing happens. And then this KL divergence turns out to be basically, it comes out in this particular case to be the quadratic error of the controller, right? Which is minimal if the control is zero. And the Bellman equation becomes linear in this case, but this is sort of an aside. And this is why, another way to see why the optimal control is basically given by this sampling solution. So that's, so you just want to find Katz's formula. It's another way of seeing it. So anyway, so for this difficult class, a large class of control problems, we can solve the optimal control instead of by the Bellman equation. We can solve it in closed form as this formula is here, as saying optimal cost to go is formula, and it's an intractable formula, something that we can estimate. And furthermore, for this class of control diffusions, you can compute an expression for the optimal control itself, also in terms of these expectation values. Now, this is basically the expected noise of the first step that we're going to make in my process. Weighted by the, under the optimal distribution. And let me explain that to you. So if I'm here and there's a pot of gold and there's nothing, if I compute the expected value of the noise, it's zero. I'm just, you know, expected noise is zero because it's a Gaussian, a zero mean a noise process. But if I weigh this by the quality of the trajectory, if this one goes to a pot of gold and this one doesn't, there will be a bias. And this bias will shift, will give a certain shift in my movement. This expectation value will be non-zero. The statement is here that non-zero number is actually equal to the optimal control in that particular state. So that's the funny thing here. But still, we have these intractable things to do, and now we have to compute it and have to try to do that efficient. I will skip this. So this is the picture on the left. You can see this is how you could do such a sampling procedure. So you want to go, this is the control problem, the time running horizontally, space is here, we start here, we want to go through one of these slits and maybe end up in the origin here. This is my control problem, I want to do. And what I just told you is that I can do it by sampling. I sample these trajectories under the uncontrolled dynamics, which is basically putting no drift into this direction. And so that all the particles will go straight ahead, basically in expectation. And most of them will hit into the wall. The wall has assigned infinite cost, and I weight these particles with the e to the minus cost. So e to the minus infinity is zero, so they get a weight zero, so they don't count. So all these particles don't contribute. Only these three lucky ones contribute to the computation. And these three samples are then used to compute the optimal control, which is this way. Now you can see that this is a highly inefficient way to compute the optimal control. It's asymptotically it's correct, but asymptotically means very many particles, and maybe I don't have time for that. So what you want to do is maybe to steer your beam of particles already into the right direction and help the sampling, because now many more survive, you have better statistics to compute, right? But this is sampling from the wrong distribution, because the theory says that you have to sample from this distribution. So this is the idea of important sampling. So let me explain that to you in this very simple one-dimensional example. So this is not about trajectory, it's just a one-dimensional variable. Say a Gaussian variable, which is distributed like this. And I want to compute an expectation value. In this case, the expectation value is the probability that this particle, this Gaussian variable, has a negative value. Right, so I have an A, the probability of x less than 0, it's the integral from minus infinity to this of an indicator function, which indicates whether it's actually less than 0, times the probability, and that's the thing I need to compute. And naively, what I do, I sample from Q, and I weigh, what is that, and then I count, right? I do it 100 times, and I count the number of times, I get 5 out of 100, so there's 5%, so my estimate of A is 0.05, right? That's what I would do, naively. I can do better, because I can sample not from this distribution, this blue distribution, but I can sample from any other distribution, for instance, this one distribution. Now, the nice thing about this distribution, that it has a larger volume area in this area where I want to be. I don't want to be for positive values, so this is better, so I get better statistics, right? So, and how do I do it? I say, okay, this quantity I want to compute, I can write it as this I times Q divided by P times P. So now I can say, okay, well, this is another problem that I want to estimate. I estimate under this distribution P of this quantity. So my quantity that I now compute is this one, is an important sampling. And so, in fact, I can do this with any distribution P, right? Any distribution gives me an unbiased estimate. Some will be more efficient than others, right? Okay, so then you can ask yourself, what is the optimal one? Now, the optimal one is, in this case, is actually taking the numerator, taking the integrand of the original expression. So if you take this, if you take the probability distribution proportional to this integrand, that's the optimal one. And so your optimal distribution will be Q times I, but then you have to normalize it. And the normalization is the integral of Q times I, which is A, which is the quantity we wanted to compute, which we don't know. Right? So this is, okay, this is sort of a hypothetical thing that we would like to have. And then, if you have that, this is extremely optimal because you only need one sample. So if you have this, so if you use this as a sampler, any sample that you take, if you put it in this formula, with now P replaced by P star, you see that the I times Q will cancel. We have the 1 over A, it comes out here, so you get 1 over N, sum over I of A. So you know, even having one particle will give you A. You will always get A. Whatever you do, that's strange, because this is a distribution. So you're getting samples which are different. So you get a stochastic, you have a stochastic process. But somehow, the way that you're weighting your samples is taking out exactly the stochasticity. So that in the net result, the weighting balance counters the stochasticity, and the end stochasticity is zero. And so, it's optimal, because every sample gives the same result, so you need only one sample, because every sample gives the same result. So you have a, right, that's optimal. 5-10 minutes? Yeah. Okay, so that is good. So how, so we can do the same in the control theory, and now our distributions are distribution of trajectories, and so we can, these expectations under the uncontrolled dynamics, the uncontrolled dynamics is not optimized for computing e to the minus s or computing dw e to the minus s. And so we can optimize, like we have here, here we have a certain cost function that we want to estimate. We can optimize our sampling for the particular cost function that we have. And in this case, it's e to the minus s that we want to optimize for. And so this expectation now that we had to compute this optimal cost to go, we can now write it as we can write this as a distribution, as an expectation with respect to another distribution, where we multiply e to the minus s by this term dq dp, which we lump into this, we call it e to the minus su. That's why this is identical, and this dq dp can be computed for these diffusion processes in closed form in terms of the control that you're using, right? So there's a one-to-one correspondence between the control that you're using, setting the way that your drift is setting your plume of particles, and the distribution. So there's a one-to-one correspondence between P and Q, P and U, and so this is the extra term that you then get. So instead of sampling under Q and having S, which only had the cost terms of the states, the phi and the v, we now sample under p, and we have to correct in this way to get the right result. So that's important sampling. So you can do, like you can use any important sampling, you can use any u to compute this quantity. So So here this left-hand side is computing the optimal cost to go, and it does not depend on, in expectation, on which controller you use. Only some controllers will be much more efficient to compute that than others. Right? And the same holds here for the optimal control. So you can use any control to compute the optimal control. So if you can measure the quality of your controller in terms, as a sampler, in terms of effective sample size. So you have, you generate samples, remember the optimal controller, all the times I have n samples, I sample from the optimal controller, they all give the same result. And so if I weight these samples, they get all weighted equally. So the optimal controller generates samples that are weighted equally. So that's what you want. Any inequality in the weighting of the samples is suboptimal. And the weighting of the samples was proportional to S, right? E to the minus S is the weighting. So if you get fluctuations in S, a lot of fluctuation in S, you get a very bad sampler. So for instance, in this case, we had a lousy sampler because a lot of samples got zero and some got non-zero. So that's a large fluctuation in the weights that you get. So we want to reduce that fluctuation. You can measure the effective sample size basically as the variance of the weights that is given by this formula here. And this number is between 1 and the number of samples. Yeah, 5 minutes. Okay, so we have a theorem that shows that better you in the sense of optimal control, so solving the original optimal control problem, is also a better sampler in the sense of effective sample size. Right, so this goes hand in hand. So that's great, because you're improving your sampler and you're improving your control, you're improving two problems at the same time. And so the optimal control corresponds to this formula. There you have the control is optimal, in fact, then this quantity, which is a stochastic quantity, becomes deterministic. So that's really quite a sort of remarkable, because x is a stochastic quantity, and u is some nonlinear function, and only if you replace this u by the optimal control function, all stochasticity disappears from this function, and it becomes deterministic, right? This is some example. Okay, so far. So I told you that optimal control can be computed by Monte Carlo sampling, and the sampling can be accelerated by using good controls, and the optimal control is also the optimal control solution. The optimal control for sampling is also for the optimal control. So how to learn now? So there's a way to do this, and I don't have time, I don't want to overstress your efforts. To have a learning method, which is uses a for any parametrized model, you can learn. Basically, it's called the coarse entropy method, and basically, it says you start with an initial distribution. So, if you want to do important sampling for this problem, and you want to sample from a distribution which is different from p zero, there is a procedure which is coarse entropy method that gives you that morphs p zero into a p one, which is better into a p two, etc. And we can do this in the same way for these particles, for this path integral control. And so, in the case of the control, P is a distribution of trajectories that corresponds to a one-to-one to a control function. So here we get the control function being morphed into another control function, etc. And this is done by gradient update. So you can use any gradient model so the algorithm is that you have some current controller that generates, and you have a model of your plant, and you generate data with that, and with that data, you then learn a controller by gradient descent, say by backpropagation in a neural network or something like that. And then this new controller is then used to generate again new data, and that is then used to improve the controller. So then you morph from this controller to that controller, maybe. That's the picture to keep in mind. So basically, this is a framework in which you can generate infinite amount of data, so you have no overfitting issues, right? You can basically push it to the limit, have infinite amount of data, and having infinitely large models, and just get arbitrarily close to the optimal controller, right? And there's no limit to that in this sandbox, except that you need very expensive computers. But this becomes an engineering problem then, whether this is really working. And this is what we've been trying to do, and we have some recent results here on the Acrobot that I want to show you. So here is the Acrobots is a second order nonlinear control problem, which is quite hard. And we have now an infrastructure where we do this, this picture. Basically, we have implemented it on very big supercomputers in the Netherlands, and we can basically want to solve any control problem. You give me your control problem, you give me your budget, how long you want to compute, and we just solve it for you to that accuracy. That's where we want to go. We're not quite there yet. In this case, for this problem, we get somewhere. So the complication of this problem is that you have that you need to learn a controller to swing up and to stay on the top, and it's an under actuated controller and there's noise in it. So here, to give some numbers, this is a neural network with 10 layers, 25 neurons per layer, and it has 500 iterations. It uses 10,000 rollouts per iterations, and it uses about 100 cores, and it does it in 15 minutes, about 3 days. I think I'm running out of my time. I wanted to also talk about the relation between control and inference and the other way. Like, so I talked about how you can morph control problem into an inference problem. You can also go the other way around. And I want to acknowledge sensorimotor, about also having an insight very many years ago. We applied it to our fMRI data. We can get wonderful results, which are much better than particle filtering. But I don't want to, you know, if you're interested in that, I can talk about that. I think that the autonomous activity of the brain is some type of Monte Carlo sampling, and it's used for planning, and it's for learning to improve the sampler and to get better and better. And it interpolates between the completely sample-based controller on the one side and the other side, the learning, the model-based, completely hardwired controller. Thank you very much.